That's nice. Thank you, Hudson. Then we'll need another cup.
Milady?
And tell Mr. Benham if she's ready, will you?
Oh, I understand the Mercer will not be requiring tea, milady. He's working on in the study and not to be disturbed.
Hasn't Miss Forrest left you?
Not yet, milady.
You shan't need another cup. Thank you, Hudson.
Oh, I bet Father wishes he'd never started on Grandpapa's biography.
Well, I think he's quite enjoying the work. It's just that his publisher wants the manuscript by the end of the month, and he still has two or three chapters left to write.
Damn hard work, I should think.
Yes, darling.
All right, Mother, I can sense the rebuke. I finished work early and came home for tea. Father is still working and hasn't time for tea. Well, my work is so dreadfully boring. It's not living, it's existing. Thank God for the weekend.
You know, your father and I are driving down to Sion tomorrow. You'll have to entertain yourself this weekend.
Yes.
Oh, by the way, such a happy letter and a parcel from Elizabeth. She sent what she calls a phonograph record for you. Gloves from Macy's in New York for me and a book for your father.
Everybody's doing it. Everybody except me.
What do you mean?
Nothing.
Elizabeth says it's the latest craze in America, this ragtime.
Yes, I know.
She and Dana and little Lucy are going to meet us off the boat on the 16th. Oh, it'd be lovely to see them.
Yes, lovely for you and Uncle Hugo and Aunt Marion.
Then we go up to Montreal. The president of the Canadian Pacific is letting us use his private railway coach right across to Alberta. We'll stay at Uncle Hugo's ranch in Calgary and... Darling, what is the matter?
Nothing is the matter.
I know you'd like to come with us. So would your father, but he's got work to do and so have you.
Well, father's work is at least interesting.
Any work's interesting if you let it be. I'm sorry if you're bored, darling, but thousands of young men slave away in offices every day to earn a living. Why should you complain? Especially after all the trouble your father took to get you into the firm.
I will not spend the rest of my life worrying about how much tea we can ship from Hong Kong to London simply to be gulped down by silly women in drawing rooms.
You're drinking tea?
Only because it's too early for whiskey.
Anyway, it was your idea to leave the army to make some money, you said.
Yes. By the time I'm a director, I shall be over 40. Half dead out in Calcutta with malaria and a rotten liver.
You know, it's not very kind of you to talk like that. Just when I'm going abroad for a month or more. You know how I worry about you.
I'm sorry, Mother.
You will help your father and the servants, won't you, while I'm away? I mean, let them know about being in or out to meals, that kind of thing.
Yes.
Something else troubling you? Phyllis?
I don't think so.
You've written to her, haven't you? I saw the letter on the hall table.
Yes. Yes, I did write to her. I thought I should congratulate her. She's got herself engaged to a fellow in Skinner's horse called Jack Pettifer. He's on the Viceroy's staff out there. A very worthy fellow with a ginger moustache.
I'm glad.
So am I.
You were right to be honest with her before it was too late.
I hope so.
There are plenty of other girls.
Yes. I think I'll take this upstairs and play it. Thank you for my tea.
All right, darling.
You finished?
Yes, Miss Bellamy. That's chapter 15, all typed.
Capital.
Oh, I managed to find the passages you wish to quote from the Lansdowne correspondence. They're marked there.
Thank you. Well, I think you've done enough for one day. You get along home.
I'd like to come again tomorrow, if it's convenient, and finish off the last two chapters, ready for your correction on Monday morning.
Well, yes, if you don't mind giving up part of your weekend.
I have nothing particular to do.
Yes, by all means. Just ring the bell and Hudson will show you in here. Would you care to leave your machine overnight?
Oh, if I may. It is rather heavy. But my train is crowded.
Well, it will be. The Metropolitan's always crowded on a Friday evening. What on earth is that noise?
It's a gramophone, I think, Mr. Bellamy. Coming from upstairs.
Must be my son. He's keen on the latest ragtime music, this dreadful syncopated jazz. Like everything else from America, it's too fast, too noisy.
Well... I say good night, then, Mr. Bellamy.
Yes, well, good night, Miss Forrest.
evening.
Good evening.
Just off?
Yes.
I hope my father's not working you too hard.
Oh, no, not at all.
Please. Oh, have you got far to go? It seems to still be raining.
No, only as far as Sloane Square.
Oh, you live in Sloane Square?
No, I get my train from there to Wimbledon.
Ah, then I must wish you a restful weekend.
Oh, I'm coming back tomorrow to finish off Mr. Bellamy's title.
Oh, dear, then you must rest on Sunday.
I expect I shall. Goodbye.
Thank goodness I'm badly behind with her ladyship's packing.
Well, I have offered to help you, Miss Roberts.
Oh, you wouldn't know what to put in Rose. She doesn't even know herself what to take.
I should think it'd be warm in Canada this time of year.
Oh, not in the Rockies, Mrs. B. No, they have snow in the Rockies all the year round. And grizzly bears.
How do you know?
I've seen pictures in magazines. It's hot in America and it's cold in Canada. So you'll have to pack everything she's got, eh, Miss Roberts?
Well, hardly. We're only taking 4 cabin trunks.
4? What, 3 for a ladyship's clothes and 1 to put you in, eh? Save paying the fare, wouldn't it?
Oh, don't be ridiculous, Edward.
Oh, I don't know. Seems like a good idea. If they packed you in a trunk across the Rockies, at least the Red Indians wouldn't get you when they hold up the train.
Oh, Edward, oh, really?
No, honestly, Mrs. B, they swoop down onto the railway line from the rocks above and then they scalp all the passengers. So if you're not hidden in a trunk, you mind to keep your hair on.
It's about time you started reading something better than checks and comic cuts, Edward.
Oh, cup of tea, Miss Rudson.
Oh, that would be most welcome, Mrs. Bridges.
Ruby, fetch a cup for Miss Rudson. Ruby!
Yes, Mrs. Bridges?
A cup for Mr. Rudson, or I'll have your scalp.
Captain James is up and about, I presume.
Do you mean Mr. James?
No, I do not, Rose. The young master may have chosen to relinquish his military duties for civilian life, but he is nonetheless entitled by custom to be known by his rank of captain.
Oh, I'm glad of that. Captain James always sounds quite romantic. Gives him an air of sort of nobility.
Well, it's about the only thing that did.
Miss Roberts, please.
Well, I suppose he'll get up sometime today.
Are you saying Captain James is still in bed?
Oh, yes. He's awake, though. He's just lying there, playing with his blessed gramophone. I've been in twice to try and do his room, but...
Well, I dare say he's tired. Working hard in that office all the week.
We are all tired, Mrs. Bridges. Edward, you better clear away the breakfast from the dining room.
What happens if he comes down wanting it?
It has gone 11:30. Breakfast has never been served in this house at 11:30. Never will be. Not as long as I'm butler here.
No, Mr. Rudson.
Well, look sharp then, Edward.
And I'll be wanting to know what my orders is for lunch.
Oh, Captain James is lunching out, Mrs. Bridges. He told me so last night.
Ah, oh, that's all right then. That just means a tray in the study.
That is correct, Mrs. Bridges. I can take Miss Forrest's luncheon tray just before we have ours.
Morning, sir.
Morning, Edward.
Oh, if you were requiring breakfast, sir, I've just cleared the dining room. But I can get you something if you'd like, sir.
No, no, I'll wait for lunch now. Overslept.
Yes, sir.
Have the master and her ladyship left?
Oh, yes, sir, at 11 o'clock, sir.
Did they? I hope I'm not disturbing you.
It's quite all right.
I was just looking for this week's punch. I thought maybe my father might have... There it is. I expect you've got quite a bit to do, have you?
Just one more chapter.
You've been hard at it all morning, haven't you?
I'm sorry if I disturbed you. This machine is very noisy, I know.
Oh, good heavens. No, you didn't disturb me. I just looked in to see if you were all right.
Yes, I am. Thank you.
Got everything you need?
Yes, I have. Thank you.
My parents have gone away for the weekend, you see.
Yes, I understand they have.
And they asked me to see that you had everything you wanted.
Yes, I have. Thank you. Your butler is arranging for me to have lunch on a tray, so that I can work on.
Oh, is he? I see. I'm looking forward to reading my father's book. Do you think it'll be a success?
Of course it will. It's very interesting. I had no idea that Lord Southwold was such a progressive underneath.
Was he? I didn't know.
Yes. He did introduce two bills in the Lords to reform the upper house. One in 1898 and one in 1907. But they wouldn't listen to him.
Oh.
He was very human, too. And he loved his family very much, didn't he? Especially his grandchildren. Well, it comes out in the letters to Lady Southwold. The Dowager, that is.
I remember, as children, we always spent Christmas at Southwold. Grandpapa rather spoilt us, I believe.
Your father has found such a charming photograph of him. Huh? And you and your sister Elizabeth, aged 10 and 8, in a pony cart. It's going in the book. Here it is. It's very sweet.
Of me? Yeah, I look like an angry little chimpanzee.
No, you don't. Well, I must be getting on. I still have a great deal to do.
Oh, no, look. It's gone midday. Why not rest for a while?
No, thank you.
Your lunch will be here soon.
Yes. I expect it will.
Have you been doing this sort of work for some time?
You mean secretarial work?
Yes.
About 10 years. Oh, of course, I've only been trained to typewrite for 3 years. Before that, I worked in a draper's in Surbiton, looking after their accounts.
Oh, you've been working a long time. I've only just started.
Were you not an officer in the lifeguards?
Yes. And now I'm a clerk with Jardine Matheson's in Lombard Street. The Far Eastern Trading Company. Also, helping in accounts in the tea department.
I see. It sounds very interesting.
So, having that much in common, I wonder, would you think it too forward of me to ask you your Christian name?
Oh.
Unless, of course, you'd rather not.
Oh, no, of course not. I don't mind. I was christened Hazel Patricia.
Hazel. Because you've got hazel eyes.
No. No, I think it was my father's love of shrubs that made him choose my name.
A charming name and most appropriate. I expect it was a good year for hazels, was it?
I don't wish to seem discourteous, Captain Bellamy, but your father is most anxious to revise the last 2 chapters on Monday morning.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. It was most wrong of me to ask you such a personal question.
It's all right.
I think it's because I find myself becoming interested in you as a person. Perhaps a little curious.
I think you should remember that I am an employee in this house. I work for your father.
I prefer to look upon you as a guest in my father's house who happens to be helping him with his manuscript.
For money, Captain Bellamy?
What difference does it make?
Well, if...
Besides, I want to know more about you. About your home, your life, your family. What you think and feel. Well?
I am an unexceptional person, Captain Bellamy.
Oh.
My life and background are ordinary and uninteresting. I find it difficult to believe that someone in your position in society should be in any way interested in someone like me. Unless you are making a study of ordinary middle-class life in the outer suburbs of London.
Oh, I assure you, Miss Forrest, I'm making a study of no such thing. I simply feel a desire to know you a little better. And I should consider it a great favour if you would allow me to call you Hazel. At least for the weekend.
Oh, excuse me, sir. Miss Forrest's luncheon.
Take the cold tongue and salad downstairs, Hudson, and lay up for two in the dining room.
For two, sir? In the dining room?
Yes, Hudson, I shall be lunching at home today, after all. And Miss Forrest will be joining me. Won't you?
Ruby, give them potatoes a prod, see if they're ready. Then you can lay out the table.
Yes, Mrs. Bridges.
What are we having today then, Mrs. Bridges?
A nice piece of roast mutton and onion sauce. What we won't have to worry over for once. Boiled potatoes and collive. And a nice treacle tart.
Oh, that should stick to my ribs all right.
I take it there's no upstairs lunch today.
Only Miss What's-her-name. I've sent her up a slice of cold tongue and salad on a tray.
No nice leftovers from the dining room today, Miss Roberts.
I'm not particularly hungry myself.
Think what you'd be having if you were at the Duke of Northumberland's place with her ladyship. I hear tell they've got a French chef at Zion Park. Haute cuisine. All garlic and cream sauces and that. How does that tickle your fancy, Miss Roberts?
What I fancy is getting her ladyship's trunks packed by Tuesday. That's what concerns me, not haute cuisine at the Duke of Northumberland's. Anyhow, I've been to Zion 3 times. The housekeeper there sends me a card every Christmas. Mrs. Raglan, very nice woman.
Mrs. Bridges, Ruby, there will be luncheon upstairs.
What?
Edward, leave that silver. Come in here at once. Look sharp now.
Captain James decided to stay in then, has he?
Impudence.
Captain James has ordered luncheon in the dining room at 1:15 for himself and the typist.
It's not.
You heard what I said, Mrs. Bridges.
Oh, trust Captain James. He's got an eye for her now, has he?
This is not a matter for jest, Edward. Go and lay 2 places in the dining room. Hurry up now.
Wine glasses or tumblers, Mr. Hudson?
Tumblers, Edward, and a jug of barley water.
Yes, Mr.
What in the name of heaven am I supposed to give him to eat, eh? Ruby!
Oh, well, that means we shan't get ours on time.
Shall I be required to wait at table, Mr. Hudson?
No, Rose, I will supervise. That'll be Captain James ringing from the morning room. Edward, see what he wants. I'll be in the pantry. And get that table lead.
It's a beautiful room.
Yes. Yes, this is the morning room, although my parents spend all day in it when they're on their own. The drawing room upstairs is for more formal occasions, like dinner parties and receptions.
It's an awful lot to keep clean.
Yes. Yes, well, Rose sees to that. She's the head housemaid. Well, we only have one at the moment. Mother's been trying to find an under-housemaid, but they're very hard to find nowadays.
You rang, sir?
Oh, yes, Edward. Ring the sherry, will you?
Oh, not for me. Thank you.
Nonsense. You must have a glass of sherry before your lunch. And 2 glasses, Edward.
Yes, sir.
You do seem to have an awful lot of servants.
Well, no. As I said, we don't have a and a housemaid, or a pantry boy, or a housekeeper. Still, we manage. Or they do.
I suppose Lady Marjorie and Mr. Bellamy have to entertain quite a bit. Being in political circles, I mean.
Is something troubling you?
No.
You keep looking at your watch.
Well, I did promise that I would finish off my work today, and I do have a great deal to do.
Oh, don't worry, you'll have time. Lunch will be here soon. Meals are always on time in this house, under the redoubtable Mr. Hudson. And with Mrs. Bridges running the kitchens like the engine rooms of a battleship, things go pretty smoothly as a rule.
Ruby, fetch up some more potatoes. Peel them and pop them in with that lot. They'll have to be mashed for upstairs.
Yes, Mrs. Bridges.
Wait! Lager first. I've got some pork chops in there. Fetch me in a couple. Look sharp.
We'll have to dapple sauce for them, then, won't we, Mrs. Bridges?
We will. You're learning, my girl. You're learning.
What green vegetables are you going to give him, Mrs. Bridges?
Spinach, so you'll have to wash it and pick it over. Now look sharp and bring me in the butter. Oh, Lord. I thought we were going to have a nice, quiet weekend.
Edward, what's that?
Well, it's sherry wanted for the morning room, Mr. Hudson.
Sherry?
Well, shall I take it in or not, Mr. Hudson?
No, Edward. For a start, those are the best glasses. I'll fetch the old ones from the pantry cupboard. Here, give me that tray. Go and get the dining room table laid.
Oh, yes, Mr. Hudson.
It was this little place called Razmak on the Afghan border. These chaps have been raiding our camp at night and trying to steal our horses. So we sent out a patrol, which I was in command of. I'm boring you, aren't I?
Not at all. It sounds most thrilling.
No, I had meant that we should talk about you. But you're so quiet and modest about yourself, here we are talking about me. And that wasn't my intention.
I do assure you, Captain Bellamy, I find your adventures on the northwest frontier most absorbing. I really do.
Now, since you have allowed me to call you Hazel, I really must insist that you call me James. Now, that's fair, isn't it?
After such a short acquaintance.
We are living in the second decade of the 20th century, Hazel. Aren't we?
Yes.
So?
All right. If you like, I will.
I will what?
I will change.
Yeah, that's better. Thank you, Hudson.
Will there be anything further, sir?
No. I take it lunch will be ready soon?
Luncheon will be served at 1:15, sir, as you ordered.
Good. By the way, we'll have a bottle of the Cantenac with our lunch. My father has this wonderful claret. You wait till you taste it.
Begging your pardon, sir, but I'm afraid I cannot serve the Chateaubriand Cantenac, sir.
Why not? I know it's not all been drunk. We had a bottle with our dinner last week.
There are certain difficulties.
Oh, what difficulties?
If I might see you, sir, in private, if you wouldn't mind, sir.
Well, if you'll excuse me.
Yes, of course.
What is all this, Hudson?
I prefer not to speak in front of the secretary, sir. But I must point out that I cannot serve the master's best claret. There are only 2 bottles left.
I ordered 1, Hudson, and I expect you to serve it.
I am sorry, sir, but I am not to serve the Chateaubriand Cantenac 93, sir, without special instructions.
Whose instructions? My father's?
Are you asking me to go against the master's wishes, sir?
Did my father forbid you to serve that claret?
He would not wish it to be served at luncheon, sir. Especially in his absence.
Hudson, are you saying he told you so?
I am not lying, sir. I know the master's general wishes as regards the best claret, and I'm endeavouring to carry them out in principle. He would not wish the wine to be served on such an occasion as this.
You mean because Miss Forrest, a secretary who earns her own living, is lunching with me in the dining room, is that it?
I can only remind you, sir, that I believe the master would not wish it. Not today, sir.
And let me remind you, Hudson, that whatever your private views may be, and in the absence of my parents, I am in charge in this house. Now, Miss Forrest is my guest for lunch. In the situation, I expect my orders to be obeyed.
Yes, sir.
And do as you're told.
Yes, sir.
Oh. There you are, Mr. Hudson. We kept yours warm. Ruby, fetch Mr. Hudson's dinner.
Pass the salt, though.
What?
Salt, please.
For the life of me, I can't see why Captain James shouldn't have his lunch in the dining room. Nor with Miss Forrest neither, not if he wants to.
If you can't see the unsuitability of such an arrangement, Rose, then perhaps it's time you look for employment in a different kind of household.
Pooh. It's you as always says that things have got to be done proper, even when the master and her ladyship are away.
It's not quite the same thing, Rose.
Well, I agree with Rose. After all, it is his house, and he does live here.
Your opinion is not sot on this matter, Edward. Get on with your dinner.
Yes, Miss Truss.
I'm sure Mr. Bellamy's typist is a perfectly respectable young woman, Rose. But she's not a lady. Now, will someone kindly pass me the onion sauce?
I may be sent out to India again one day. The Calcutta office.
That's a long way from the northwest frontier.
Oh, yes. It's a very different climate and a very different way of life. I shall probably end up in Calcutta with a liver. Those people seem to.
Thank you. I do hope not. I've always longed to visit the Far East. Is it very wonderful?
Oh, yes. Yes, I saw the Himalayas at sunrise once.
Was it a very inspiring sight?
Well, it should have been, but it was after a rather wild party in the mess. I'd fallen down in the garden and given myself a black eye. They were good days. Tell me, have you been abroad much yourself?
No. I've never been further from Wimbledon than a day's excursion to Margate for Easter.
Oh?
Oh, I was in Newcastle once, but not for long.
Oh, and what were you doing in Newcastle?
Oh, it's something I'd really rather not talk about.
Leave the coffee, will you, Hudson?
Very good, sir.
They're annoyed with me, aren't they, James?
Annoyed? Who?
Your butler. He disapproves of me having my lunch with you. I can sense it.
It is not for Hudson to approve or disapprove.
I could feel his angry looks going through me like knives.
Hudson doesn't run this house.
Well, I don't feel very comfortable sitting here, James. And if you'll excuse me, I think I'd really rather go back to the study. Oh, I don't mean to sound ungrateful. It was terribly kind of you to keep me company and give me such a nice lunch. But anyway, I did promise your father to have the work finished and ready for him by Monday morning.
No need to say more, Hazel. I understand completely. Come along now.
Mind you, don't break nothing today, Ruby. The mood Mr. Hudson's in, he'll knock your block off.
Short, Mrs. Bridges.
Oh, look at the time. It's gone 2:30. I'm never going to be there. Not by 4. Not by omnibus, Rose.
Don't worry, Edward. I'll speak to Mr. Hudson about it.
Speak about what, Rose?
Oh, well, Edward's supposed to have the afternoon off, Mr. Hudson. He's going out to Putney to see his granny, aren't you?
Yeah.
I was aware of that.
Well, if he's got to clear away in the dining room, it's going to make him ever so late getting there, so I was going to suggest that I did it instead, and I'm quite willing.
Very well, Rose. If you wish to assist me, I have no objection. Away and get changed, Edward.
Oh, thanks, Mr. Hudson. Here, tar, Rose. You are a brick.
Don't forget to take that seedy crate to your granny or Mrs. Bridges will skin you alive.
Oh, yeah. Where is it?
On the kitchen table.
Oh, tar. Cheerio.
Yes, sir?
Hello, Hudson. I want to talk to Lord Newbury. I take it you have the number there.
I'll have to look it up, sir. If you'd replace your receiver, I'll ring through in a minute. according to Lord Newbury now. That'll mean a night out in the tiles.
Rose, come in here, will you? Quickly. Newbury, Lord Newbury, look up the number for me, will you? I must have left my spick somewhere.
Newbury, Marquis of Grosvenor, 2316.
Thank you. Hello? Would you connect me, please, with Grosvenor, 2316?
Hello? Oh, thank you. Is that Newbury House? I want to talk to his lordship. Hello, buddy? Jimmy. I said, can you collect me in your motor car? Save me the cab fare out to Hurlingham. Well, it's on your way. Splendid. That'll be topping. Well, if we can't find any girls, we play a singles. What? For a sovereign? Done. Oh, and decide what we're going to do tonight. No, Bunny, not the Ritz. I'm stony broke. The trot, perhaps, if we can rake up some girls. No, I haven't. Not at the moment. No one in particular.
I know what you're thinking, Mr. Hudson. You're thinking that our Captain James has been up to his old tricks again, aren't you?
I don't know what you mean by old tricks, Rose.
Bowled up with Sarah and everything.
The young master has always shown a regrettable disdain for young females of his own class.
Oh, do you mean he likes them common? I don't think that matters very much anymore. Not nowadays. Not with everything going all topsy-turvy now.
Then I wonder what you or I or any of us are doing in domestic service, Rose. If a hired typist can sit at luncheon in this dining room drinking the master's best claret, I might as well go out and stand for Parliament.
Mr. Hudson!
Proper standards must be maintained in this household, Rose. Her ladyship's standards. Oh, there's no future for any of us. None.
Mr. Hudson, you're getting things all out of proportion. You don't want to let Captain James upset you. Anyhow, her ladyship will be back again tomorrow.
Take that tray downstairs, Rose, if you would.
Yes, Mr. Hudson.
I beg your pardon, miss.
I have left my typewriting machine in the study. Mr. Bellamy said I might.
Yes, miss.
And I shall be here at the usual time on Monday morning. Good day.
If you'll pardon me, sir.
Yes, what is it, Hudson?
I would like to speak to you, sir, if I may, on a personal matter.
As long as it doesn't take too long, I shall be going to Hurlingham to play tennis as soon as Lord Newbury arrives.
It won't take long, sir.
Well?
I feel bound to inform you, sir, that the staff were very much upset by the last-minute arrangements made for luncheon today.
Oh.
You had informed me yesterday evening that you would be lunching out. I myself was particularly upset by the orders I received from you, sir, regarding the service of the claret.
Then you had no cause to be.
I fear I must disagree with you, sir.
What?
I have reflected on this matter very carefully, sir.
Well?
I am the butler here. And I think you will appreciate that the master and the ladyship rely on me, indeed expect me to maintain order in the running of this house. And see to it that things involving the staff are properly carried out, the ordering and service of meals at the proper time and so forth. Lately, I have found increasing difficulty, sir, in assimilating your personal orders in the house with the method and routine as laid down by her ladyship. I fear today has proved that I no longer enjoy the authority of a butler here, which makes it impossible for me to continue in your parents' service. Therefore, I shall see the master and her ladyship on their return tomorrow and ask them to accept a week's notice. That is all I have to say, sir.
Excuse me.
Are they back, Hudson?
The master and her ladyship are in the morning room, sir.
Oh, hello. How are things down at Sion? Did you have a good drive back?
What the devil do you think you've been doing, James?
What?
You know damn well what I mean.
How can I till you tell me?
And don't you be flippant.
Hudson's just been in to see us.
Well?
He's given us a week's notice.
And you know why? Don't you?
Well, he did mutter something yesterday about leaving for the simple reason that I ordered lunch in the dining room, which evidently didn't fit in with his plans. Also, I think because I ordered him to serve a bottle of wine from the cellar. Well, quite frankly, I didn't think he'd carry out his threat.
Well, yes. And I leave for Canada on Wednesday. That means your father will be left here with no butler.
Exactly.
Well, all I can say is he'd be better off without Hudson if he continues in his present mood.
Hudson happens to be a very good butler, James. As good as you'd find anywhere. He's served your mother and me well since before you were born. He's a man of high principles. And as you well know, he cares deeply for our family. Its welfare and honor. And he expects things to be done correctly.
Then he should obey my orders when I give them.
Your orders?
Yes, my orders. I live here.
Yes, and what sort of orders, eh?
You did put Hudson in a very difficult position, darling. By inviting your father's typist to lunch in the dining room and ordering that bottle of wine.
But what's the wretched man to do? He knows I do not allow my best claret to be drunk at luncheon. You're showing off to Miss Forrest, weren't you? Trying to impress her.
I was not showing off. I was showing her the common courtesy of lunching with her as a token of what I hope is your gratitude, Farmer, for all the extra work she has done for you over the weekend.
It is not for you to extend courtesies to my secretary.
I thought it was about time somebody did. Her lunch, if you can call it lunch, was brought to her in the study on a tray.
Those were my orders, James.
And no business of yours. What right have you got to countermand your mother's orders?
James, how could you of all people think it suitable for Miss Forrest to have lunch in the dining room?
She happens to be extremely nice and very respectable.
I've no doubt she's respectable, but she can't have much taste or judgment to have accepted your invitation in her position.
Why not? Because she's helping Father type his manuscript and lives in Wimbledon.
Darling, you're being deliberately blind. If you invited Miss Forrest to have supper in a restaurant, nobody would object. But to take her into the dining room and expect the servants to wait on her and to humiliate Hudson in front of a woman of her class...
I did not humiliate Hudson.
You placed him and the other servants in an impossible position. With the result, you upset them all downstairs and Hudson is leaving.
All I can say is if he chooses to leave over so trifling a matter, let him go.
I have no intention of letting him go, James. You're going to see Hudson and apologize to him.
Oh, Richard, no.
I say yes. You can say it was an error of judgment and apologize to the man.
No, I won't have my son apologize to a servant in a situation like this. What are you thinking of?
Hudson is not an ordinary servant.
He's not to apologize to Hudson or any of them. Good gracious, if anyone should apologize, it's your typist. For daring to think it right for her to have lunch in the dining room. She could have refused. I blame her.
Well, I don't.
It was I who invited her to lunch, and Hudson made her feel extremely awkward.
No doubt she was highly embarrassed by the whole situation. If she had any decency, she'd resign. In fact, I think, in view of the situation, you should terminate her engagement here at once.
I shall do nothing of the kind, Marjorie. To start with, she has at least another week's work clearing up papers and God knows what else. And for another, I am not allowing Miss Forrest to be made a scapegoat for your son's gross stupidity.
Look, Mother, I am perfectly prepared to go to Hudson, admit I made a mistake, and ask him to reconsider his decision.
There.
No, James, I don't want that, and I don't want any more said about it tonight. Well, just give Hudson time to cool off. I'll probably have a word with him in the morning.
By that time, he'll have packed his bags and gone.
I think not, Richard, and you really must leave these things to me.
Oh.
Your father and I are having a little cold supper in a few minutes. Have you dined?
Yes, at the club. If you'll excuse me.
Supper is served, milady.
Oh, thank you, Hudson. Shall we go in?
I still can't see why you had to go and give in your notice.
Can't you?
Are you telling me you're walking out of here and her ladyship going off to Canada Wednesday?
There was no other way of drawing their attention to Captain James's carryings on. It's time to put a stop to it, in my opinion.
Oh, I see.
I've no doubt his father's given them a piece of his mind. At all events, the young whippersnapper's gone crawling off to his room.
And them not speaking to each other, eh? Sounds to me as if her ladyship took his part.
Doesn't she always?
A nice thing for her ladyship. Going off Wednesday for 2 months and leaving a nasty atmosphere in the house.
I dare say I shall consider my position very carefully, Mrs. Bridges, between now and Wednesday.
I hope you will. It's only 3 days.
And I put the key to your jewelry case in your black handbag, m'lady.
Thank you, Robert.
Oh, I just hope you'll have enough warm clothing for the boat in the one cabin trunk. The other three go down into the hold, I understand. And we shan't see them again until we get to New York.
No, that's right. You know that the break's coming at 10 o'clock.
Yes, m'lady, so Hudson told me.
To take you, Lady Southwell's maid, and Lord Southwell's valet to the station. Edward's going too, to take care of the luggage.
Very good, m'lady. Well, that's everything done, then.
Why don't you go and wait in the servants' hall till the break comes, Roberts?
Very good, m'lady. I just hope it gets here in time.
I promise you we won't miss the boat train, don't worry.
No, m'lady. It's just that I get train fever, m'lady.
Excuse me, my lady.
Yes, Hudson.
I was hoping to see the master and yourself today, my lady, before your departure.
Oh, well, Mr. Bellamy's just gone round to Pont Street to the chemist to try and get me something in case of seasickness. It shouldn't be very long, unless you'd like to talk to me alone.
In the circumstances, my lady, I would. I just wanted to say, I acted in haste, giving notice on Sunday night. And I would now ask your ladyship and the master to consider the whole incident closed.
Well, nothing could please me more, Hudson. If you're really quite sure you want to continue in service with us.
I am quite sure, my lady.
What made you change your mind?
Only one consideration, my lady. Whatever may have been done and said in this house since the weekend, and some bitter things have been said, my lady, both above and below stairs, I could not, on the eve of your ladyship's departure, abandon my post here. I'm aware that my resignation has caused not only trouble for Captain James, but a certain difference of opinion between the master and yourself. And I would not care to see you leave behind any sense of disharmony in your house, my lady.
That's very thoughtful of you, Hudson, and I'm most relieved.
Perhaps you would convey my feelings to the master, my lady, as soon as possible.
Yes, of course I will.
Oh, beg pardon, m'lady. Just to say the luggage brakes arrived.
Oh, thank you, Edward. Well, Hudson, perhaps if you'd go and see to things.
Very good, m'lady. Thank you.
Good night, Ruby, and be good.
All ready, Miss Roberts? Luggage is all in the van.
Very well. Well, goodbye. Oh,
goodbye.
Goodbye.
Come on.
Goodbye.
Come on, Miss Roberts.
Bon voyage, Miss Roberts.
Watch how you go.
That's everything in the motor, my lady.
Good. Well, perhaps we had better go.
Servants and luggage have left, I take it.
Oh, 5 minutes ago, sir. Edward will see the trunks onto the boat train, sir, and find the reserved seats.
Oh, by the way, Captain James and I hope to catch an afternoon train back from Southampton, so we shall be here in time for dinner.
Very good, sir.
Well, Marjorie.
Take care of everything, won't you, Hudson?
Indeed, my lady. A pleasant voyage, my lady.
Thank you.
My apologies, Hanson. I won't care again.
Yes, sir.
Time next week, she'll be in New York with Miss Lizzie. Oh, well.
Oh, shall I return these reports to the House of Lords Library, sir? I've copied out the items we needed from them.
Yes, send them back. Oh, and please return these diaries to the librarian at Southwell before they get lost.
Yes, of course.
Oh, sorry to disturb you, Father.
Yeah?
Just returning your copy of Punch. I borrowed it.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, James. You off to work?
Yes, it's such a lovely morning, I thought I'd walk part of the way. And I need the exercise.
Yes, well, you better get off then.
Goodbye, Father.
Bye.
Miss Forrest.
This is wonderful news, Miss Forrest. Just listen. This is from Mr. Sayers at Macmillan's. This is to advise you that Mr. Frederick Macmillan and I, as well as two other directors, have now read the draft manuscript of your Life of Lord Southwold and feel you would like to know that we are unanimous in our praise of the work, finding it informative, entertaining, well documented, and in every way a most excellent and acceptable political biography. He goes on to say, we hope to send it for printing in early June.
That is good news, Mr. Bellamy. You must be very pleased.
Oh, yes, I'm delighted and relieved. If only this letter had arrived 3 days ago before my wife left for Canada, how thrilled she would have been.
Could you not write and tell her the news at once?
Oh, there's no point. By the time my letter got to New York, she'd be halfway across Canada.
I see. What a shame. Mm. Could you not send her a wireless message to the ship?
A Marconigram? Yes, I'll do that. Then she'll get it to sea. Well done, Miss Forrest.
Shall I take down the message?
Yes, and Edmund can run round to the Marconi office with it. So, a wireless message to Lady Marjorie Bellamy, stateroom number 6, aboard White Star Liner Artemis Titanic, en route from Southampton to New York. Date April 12th, 1912. My message reads, Macmillan's delighted and impressed with manuscript. Take good care of yourself. All my fondest love, Richard.